Welcome to OB Boss Babes.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited.
I'm so excited to have you here. Steph, let's go into your time capsule and let's go back a few years when you were working for an American fitness company, thou shalt not be named, when you brought Pop Pilates to the Ottawa Valley. Mm-hmm. I was a longtime supporter. I think I even remember telling you, I'm like, you've inspired me. I want to become a Pop Pilates instructor. I loved it. So in a nutshell, can you talk about your experience working for this company and how you went from being their social media manager while also showcasing your own fitness journey on your own personal social media back basically before when you started your xogingy brand?
Yeah. It was amazing working for this company because I got to do two things I loved at once, which was social media, content creation, building a community online, and then at the same time, I was passionate about fitness, and that person's brand and company like changed my life physically. Like, that's why I got into health and fitness. So it was so cool that I was able to, you know, meet in the middle of, like, I love social media and I love fitness. So I learned a lot, and that was actually the first ever time that I got to experience what it felt like to have a lot of flexibility and freedom in a job. Mm-hmm. Right? Like, I was working from home from this company that was based out of California. I had my own, you know, my own schedule. I had a lot of freedom and initiative in the position. So I learned a lot about business. I also learned a lot of, like, what it looks like behind the scenes to actually create content, to actually be on social media. And then I just realized that it was so funny because I was working for them, but then in my spare time, I was doing the same thing in terms of social media, but for me. And mm-hmm. so I was like this, almost like this dual energy of like, wow, I'm getting paid from this company, but I'm more excited to like end the work for the day and then work on my own social media, even if it was just completely free and in my own community. So when that role ended, I was like, well, what do I do now? Like, I'm like, I'm not getting a real job. Like, I just worked from home, and it was my boyfriend at the time, my husband now, was like, why don't you just start selling your own fitness programs to your own audience? And I was like, oh. But like, there was still like this disconnect of like, how the hell do I do it? But that's essentially how it kind of all transitioned.
Well, yeah. Let's talk about that stuff, because you were selling those fitness programs for $14.99,
yeah.
Which is so funny, I'm yeah. sure, like, to look back on that and think, like, oh my gosh, I was so underselling myself for these workout plans. And then you were also hosting, like, in-person retreats and mm-hmm. events. You were bringing people to the Ottawa Valley community. Mm-hmm. You were really showcasing our community and yourself and, like, the businesses, mm-hmm. the fitness center you were going to. Like, you were doing a great job at that. And just kind of, you know, thinking back to even your experience, you know, working for this company, you were building a brand before you even realized it. Like, you were already kind of understanding the social media algorithm. You knew what your mm-hmm. followers wanted. You knew what your clients had wanted. Mm-hmm. And you were building this brand behind the scenes before you realized what you were doing.
Yeah. And I think that it's so fun. And I'm so glad that I didn't have the awareness that that's what I was doing, because I was just doing what I loved. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm just going to document my life. I'm going to share. I'm going to, you know, then I fell in love with content creation. Then I was noticing like, oh, like, I'm building community. I'm creating these connections from all over the world. And then that motivated me to, like you were saying, like, in our local area, I was like, oh, I'm going to use this gym and the resource here and the resource here to, like, bring in, like, my local element to what I was doing online. So,
which I really like, because obviously that's what my podcast is all about. It's all about bringing awareness to local businesses mm-hmm. and utilizing and outsourcing within your own communities, yeah. right? And you, I mean, not that you had been that big at the time, but mm-hmm. you were attracting, you know, people in the States, like your mm-hmm. women customers in the States and all over the world. Like, you were literally have people flocking to the Ottawa Valley. I remember your last event that you had held right before the pandemic hit. Like,
yeah.
you had people all over the world that had come.
Yeah, we've had many retreats and summits where people, like, from all over the world would yeah. come to fly to Ottawa and then get in a car to Pembroke, like, little Pembroke, Ontario, Ottawa Valley, which I think is just, that's the power of real connection, though.
Yeah.
It's like, people will go anywhere where they feel connected, where they feel part of something.
So, Steph, your brand started as Courageously Confident, and you were selling programs like Courageously Confident, Confidence to Cash. You had the whole confidence mm-hmm. thing going. And then you made the shift over to becoming a social media business coach. So how did you strategically make that transition without flipping your business completely overnight?
Yeah. It's something I talk about all the time, is when you have a brand and you have a community of people who love you, not just your product, then you can transition what you're selling and it still works. Mm-hmm. So I went from, you know, fitness and being about one thing, and then I fell in love with business and social media and wanting to teach people that. And so I didn't have to really start over because I had an audience of people who like loved me, Stephanie, and were interested in no matter what it was that I was offering. So the transition was super smooth.
It seems seamless because I remember watching as a very dedicated follower. I remember watching and seeing that you were kind of slowly making that shift over. Yeah. Your fitness programs were kind of integrating along with the social media management aspect and how you were kind of targeting your audience and what you were saying. And I was like, how is the fitness portion, you know, how does that integrate with each other? And I think that when you finally made the announcement to say, like, this is my last fitness program, I'm done, I've now realized my new passion. Mm-hmm. And so I think that it was really smart of how you did that. And you didn't just make that shift overnight. That, yeah, like I said, you seamlessly did it, but strategically.
Yeah, I didn't, like, I took my audience along for the journey, mm-hmm, right? So there was a time where it was like, okay, I'm not just fitness anymore. I'm going to start to talk a little bit of, like, mindset and goal setting, yes, and entrepreneurship, but still fitness. And so it was both. And that transition was like, what are the similarities between fitness and business? So then a lot of the themes overlapped. And then whenever I made the announcement, it didn't feel like, hey, I'm not doing this anymore, I'm only doing this. It was just like, hey guys, I'm going to talk to you about where I'm at and what I'm feeling, and this is what it's going to look like going forward. And I, yeah, feel like that people really respond to that because they feel like, oh, I understand, like, I'm part of her journey and her community. It's not just like, see you later, now I'm doing this. And I think that's why it was so well received. And it's really incredible because I have people in my business courses right now who found me way back when I was only doing fitness, took my fitness stuff, and at that time they had no interest in doing an online thing, but now they're in my online courses for business. And it's just so fun to see, like, the same people stick with you even though you change, you know, what you're selling.
Well, speaking of your program, Steph, we need to talk about it because your programs, your mentorship, your masterminds, they all focus on how to sell, gain and retain clients and make money every day in your business. And you launch your masterminds with little information, and you openly talk about this with your clients.
Yeah.
You tease your audience, you know, with minimal details, and you attract hell yes clients without really saying anything.
Yeah.
That is, I think, everybody's dream, right?
I think it's so funny because it is. But to me, I'm like, of course, because, you know, I talk about brand all the time, mm-hmm, brand, content, connection. When you have that within your free content, you put out an offer, people don't need to know all those details because they basically already know and trust you because of your content. So I always focus on, like, showcasing who I am, what I'm about, giving value in my content. So when I put out an offer, I don't need a big long list of things and people are like, yes. And so it's like, to me, it's so simple, but brand is hard. Brand is hard. Community is hard. Those relationships are hard. So if you're not dedicated to it, then you are going to need to sell in a different way of, like, giving all the details, and your launches and all these things are going to feel harder, but it's been easy. And that's why I teach people content, 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 brand, 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 because, like, that will be your reality.
So I've noticed that, actually, you know, like, your unicorn magic, if you will, in my own brand, because when I have said, you know, because I sell sponsorships for my podcast, mm-hmm, and I remember I put out a call to action for people, you know, I've got an offer for sponsorships that are available, and I had people saying yes, and then they said afterwards, they said, wait, so what does a sponsorship entail?
What am I doing?
After they had already sent the money, and I thought, I just pulled a Steph Schultz move.
Yes.
Like, I was able to attract people without selling myself of what I'm putting out there. And I think that's really smart and able to do that. And if you're in your business and you're able to do that, you're doing something right.
Yeah. And I can see how sometimes people think that it's, like, fishy or, like, you, like, scam, but it's not, because, mm-hmm, people are saying yes because they feel like they trust you. That, mm-hmm, you know what I mean? So I just think, like, those kinds of connections are the strongest.
So, Steph, you have said that you can build a multi-million dollar coaching business by creating brand awareness without hiring a graphic designer, creating a website, or paying for ads. But what you need is passion, a vision, and your phone to show up and show people what you're all about. Those are your words exactly.
I'm like, what post was that?
I know. That's good. So how have you mastered building brand awareness, and how has it transformed your business?
When I think of brand, it really comes back to the easiest way to create a brand is you're being yourself. So my brand is like, yeah, it's business and business coaching and you know, and money and sales and entrepreneurship, but my brand is pink. My brand is confident and bubbly and successful and all those things, and that's me. So when you can create brand elements and a feeling that's based off of your true, genuine personality, that's how you create something that stands out. And then you pull on different elements. Like, it's so funny. I think the first time, it was maybe the CC Summit, that pink lipstick was put on me, and then it just became a thing out of nowhere, and then now it's part of my brand. You know what I mean? And so it's just like those little quirks, those little elements that are unique to you, really magnify them in your brand, and that's how you really stand out and people feel connected to those little things.
Well, I mean, I think you're speaking right for example of that with all the pink anyways. Now, as content creators building personal brands, it is essential to understand the social media algorithm to stay on top of the social media world, impact people, and share your passion with everybody. So, Steph, how on earth do you keep up with the trends and teach clients then how to scale their social media through your programs?
You know, it's really natural to me because it's so funny. I tell this in my programs. Like, I feel like I'm one with Instagram. Like, I just get it. Since day one, I've always just understood how it works and how people are consuming content. And I've seen it over the years change. So the trends. And so honestly, for me, just when I'm naturally on Instagram, I see like, oh, now this kind of content is doing well. This kind of content is doing well. And I'm able to create my own content in a really natural way. And then after I create, I kind of just reverse engineer the process. And then I teach that in my offers. So it really just comes from me consuming and taking messy action to create my own content. And then I see what works. And then when it works, I'm like, how did that work? And then I teach the how.
I was just going to say, yeah, because so many people are like, how do you just understand it? How? And you're just like, take my program and you'll see.
Yeah. But the way for me is like, I just try things with no expectation of like, oh, is this going to go viral or whatever. I try it because I genuinely love creating it. And then I notice when it works for me, I'm like, what about that? And then I kind of dissect it. And then that's how I teach it.
So Steph, the worst thing that can happen to your social media account is when you get hacked. And you not only got hacked once, but multiple times, and your account got shut down and you actually had to start over.
So I don't actually even know if mine got hacked, but it just got shut down. I didn't, like, it never got hacked. I'm not aware of that. It just got shut down.
It just got shut down. So what happened? Like, did you just go to log in one day and you just couldn't log in? Or, like, what happened?
You're bringing me back to, like, the worst.
I know. You're like no, PTSD. Okay.
No. Actually, though, so I'll talk about that. But literally all that happened was I went and clicked on my phone and clicked on Instagram just as I would. And there's, like, this big notification that's, like, your account has been disabled. Like, if you want to claim that this is a mistake, like, click here. This was in the middle of the night, by the way, and I was alone. Eric was gone. And so I like, so that's what happened. It just, and it's, what's interesting is I had saw that this had happened to other people. So I had some connections of like, what do I actually do? Because to contact Instagram, it's kind of impossible. So you can kind of basically say that it's a mistake and it may come back. So I kept, people were saying it may come back. So I was just waiting, and then it didn't come back. And so I created my new account. But it was, you know, it's so crazy because, and I know that you're going to ask this or we'll talk about it, but like it in that moment, I was like, everything is gone.
Yeah.
Like I thought about all of my connections, my community, all of the content. Like even if you save stuff, it's like to see that gone, it just felt like it was the worst feeling in the world.
Well, it's like everything disappears because it's like you're not only your content is gone, your followers are gone.
Yeah.
Everything that you've worked hard, your brand.
Yeah.
Your brand. It's gone.
Yeah.
It's disappeared. And there is not a guarantee that it's going to ever come back. I had another business owner who this happened to, but she was trying to get verified on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And she got an email that said, oh, your account has been verified. Clicked the link.
No.
And it like got in. And so basically how I view it, kind of similarly with yours, is that someone broke into your house, took the key, locked and waved at you and said, good luck getting back in. But Steph, what I really admired is that like anybody, you know, you freaked out, you panicked, and you're like, what the hell just happened to me? But you utilized Facebook. You utilized your Facebook community, and you had already had created a business group for everybody. Yep. Like, you had already had your Facebook community, and the majority of your followers were already in your group. And then you launched a program called The Return.
Yeah.
So not only did you, you know, take this as a learning opportunity, but you basically said, F you, Instagram. I'm going to come back better than ever.
Yeah, I mean, I had two options. Like,
thanks for tuning in to the OV Boss Babes podcast and for watching their anniversary special exclusively on Spotify. We'll be right back after we take a look at our sponsors.
There's a wide range of things to see and do throughout Laurentian Valley for the whole family. Get out and explore the various biking, walking, ATVing, and snowmobile trails. Brew your own wine and beer, spend an afternoon at an agritourism adventure or numerous parks, or grab your skates and hit up Laurentian Valley's skating trail. Take your time and discover more what makes Laurentian Valley special. Check out our business directory at directory.lvtownship.ca to register your business or to explore others nearby. You remember Amanda Tucker Media, right? In the past 2 years, the Ottawa Valley has given back so much to her that her marketing business has grown into a team of five. To stand out on social media, you must be recognizable, memorable, and most importantly, relevant. Amanda Tucker Media specializes in helping brands with their online social media presence through cutting-edge social media, content marketing, and professional photography and videography services. Social media marketing is constantly changing, and in order to make that balance between what you say and what your audience wants to hear, you need a thought-out, intentional strategy to tell your brand story. Let's break the noise and make a lasting impression with your audience. Follow Amanda at amandatalker.media for social media tips on Facebook and Instagram, and check out her website to see how she can help you level up your biz.
Hey there. We're the Prosper Company, a husband and wife duo based out of the Ottawa Valley, specializing in photography, videography, and production. We love working with local businesses, families, and individuals in the Ottawa Valley and surrounding area to help tell their stories. We specialize in a few areas of photography, videography, and production, including corporate and small business, real estate, aerial and drone, 3D Matterport tours, branding, event and business promotion, as well as family photography. So, whether you're a newly engaged couple, entrepreneur, business owner, or looking to celebrate a significant milestone in your life, we'd love to hear from you and help to tell and share your story. You can visit us online at www.prospercompany.net or follow us on Instagram and Facebook. We look forward to chatting with you soon.
Hey Ottawa Valley Boss Babe, it's me Hazel, local celebrity, micro-influencer, dog aunt, and now badass virtual assistant. I know that business owners have a lot on their plate, and one way to reclaim time to focus on their passion and artistry is to hire a virtual assistant. Hire a Hazel. Thank you for watching the OV Boss Babe's anniversary special with special guest xogingy.
Do nothing and cry about it, or just like, what are you gonna do? And so I had an email list, I had, you know, my Facebook community, and when that happened, we said, like, I never send emails, I don't do email marketing, but I sent an email to my community and said, my Instagram is gone, like, I never ask for anything from you guys, but can you please just like say that this was a mistake, report it, come into the Facebook. And so it was really incredible to see my community like support me. And then it was like, this is how I am, if something happens, I'll, you know that quote that's like, cry about it or boss up? I'm like, I'm gonna cry about it and then I'm gonna boss up. So it's literally like, what is the story that I'm gonna tell, right? And so it was like, let's do a program. There's a lesson here that I wanna talk to people about. We created a video. We documented the whole experience. And I'm really proud of what we did because, you know, whether it's an Instagram being disabled or something that you build just for whatever reasons, you know, gets knocked down, you can always overcome it. And that, I mean, that's how I am with everything. But the way that we decided to share that story and create a video, I feel like that message really landed strongly in my community.
Well, not to mention the relatability. Because like we were saying, this has not just happened to you, it's happened to multiple people.
Right.
And it does continue to happen on a daily basis. And the hackers, they're going to, like the hackers or whoever, you know, is behind the master manipulation of getting, you know, these accounts, like, they're going to do it and it's going to happen and we're going to get tricked or fooled or something.
And but you're going to be okay.
You're
going to be okay.
But you know what though? The best thing about it is that your community will always support you and they will come back and, you know,
and that's champion. When you know you built something real. When like I had people messaging me for that month where I didn't create a new account yet saying like, I miss your morning posts. I miss your story. Like that really, I always knew that, but that made me realize that like, I wasn't just someone on social media, like I was part of people's days on Instagram because I was posting. Like I was like that one morning post that made someone's day and made them feel good. And I was like, wow, like that really solidified, like we've created something bigger than just, you know what I mean? A social mm-hmm. media platform.
Well, and you've not only created something bigger, but I mean, you have not done this alone. And I want to say that in the sense of like having a team, but you've also had a coach and a mentor. Mm-hmm. And many women are hiring business coaches to help them strategically build their businesses and build their brand, generate more income, and be successful in creating brand awareness. Now, Steph, you yourself had, and I think if I'm correct, you still have a coach.
Yep.
And you sought out your coach back when you didn't necessarily have the funds mm-hmm. to pay for her. But you knew very early on again the importance of investing in yourself. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about this actually on my drive today, and I'm like, you know what? We all invest in ourselves when we go to school. Mm-hmm. We all, you know, like we don't have that education, and so we're going to invest to go to school, get the education to create to get a career. That is no different than hiring a business coach.
100%.
So why should every business owner hire a coach, whether it's a business, mindset, confidence, empowerment, or a social media organic marketing coach?
You know, it's so fun, and I don't know why I had this mindset, but since the beginning, when I had no idea what I was about to create, I had this feeling like I'm about to create something big, and I don't know exactly what I'm doing, and it's new territory, not just strategically, but like as a human navigating it all. So since the beginning, I looked at having a coach as an insurance policy. And that's why I still have one today. It's like, I know that I'm going to be creating something brand new. I'm going to make mistakes. I'm going to have to go through all of like the ups and downs emotionally. I want someone who has done this already to be able to guide me, not only practically, but in my mindset. Mm-hmm. And so that's how I saw it since day one. So it didn't feel like, oh my God, a big gamble. It was like, if I really want to build something big, it made sense to invest at the beginning, even though it didn't make sense. And so I think a lot of people struggle with having that long-term mindset because you're only thinking now. You're like, well, I haven't made money yet, or I'm scared to invest because what if it? And I totally get that. But to me, it's like I had those same fears, but I knew if I really want to create something big and feel supported, it just makes sense.
I think another thing too is that not only that you get what you pay for, but it's the same thing with investing. If you don't invest in yourself, you're only going to grow so far.
Stay small.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I mean, I could say that same thing with my podcast. Like for something like this today, I have to fork out money for it.
Yeah.
But
the long-term ROI of yes. all of this in this short term doing it is going to like, you're going to reach so many more people. You're going to have content for days. Like it's like, yeah. So you were like, this is a short term thing to do, but what happens from this is going to go your lifetime, which I think is so exciting, right?
Thank you. Yeah. And it's so true. I think that the importance of investing in yourself, whether it is education, hiring a coach or mentor, building your brand, getting that graphic designer or whatever it is, you know, that you need to succeed, mm-hmm. it is worth every penny and mm-hmm. it will pay off in the long run.
You just have to trust that it does because you won't see it right away. But it's easier said than done when yeah. I know I have the evidence, but like it is scary, but just you've got to have skin in the game. And I think the reason why a lot of people don't is because they're like, if I fully invest in something, that means I really have to show myself I can do it. But that's also part of why it works, because it expands you.
Now, Steph, I have a question for you that I know a lot of other people do. And that is, there's so many coaches in the industry mm-hmm. and a lot of them are millennials. So how did they obtain the skill sets to be able to confidently teach others how to create and lead their own successful businesses when they're so young?
Well, there's a few different things to this. One, I think it's because of like millennials' social media. It's so natural for us to be like on our phone, understand social media. And we are the age to at the time that the industry was really popping on social media. You know what I mean? So it was like, it was there. But here's the thing is I used to have the fear that if I'm young, people won't hire me because I'm young. Mm-hmm. But I quickly realized that it's not about the age, it's about the wisdom. So at 26, I invested big in my business. And at 26, I did a lot of mindset work that I, like, people double my age don't even know exists. So it was like, oh my God, I started to see people older than me were hiring me. And it was not because of age, but because of wisdom. So I think that the right coaches, the right people are gaining life experience by building businesses, by doing work, by getting coached. And it doesn't matter how old you are. If you do that work on yourself, you're able to lead anyone through the same work.
Now, here's a question for you. Why are these coaches so expensive? And and my other one is, why do clients get so excited to pay in full? Because I'm going to tell you right now, Steph, I do not get excited to pay in full my Visa. I do not get that energy to be like, yes, I paid so my Visa. I mean, actually, you know what? Scratch that, actually. I do get slightly excited to pay my Visa off because I'm like, okay, I'm at a zero balance. But your clients, like your clients specifically, like they are actually genuinely celebrating and excited.
Because it's not even just the money. It's the money is a representation of what they're doing. So they're excited to say yes to something really big. They're excited to commit to another level on their business. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what they get so excited about. Why is it so expensive? It's so funny. It's like, it just is. Like, it just, like, when it comes to mentoring, the way that I see it is if someone wants to come and says to me, Steph, I want to build a multi-7-figure business, well, you know, like, of course you're going to pay 50K or 40K or whatever. You know what I mean? It just, like, yeah, it needs to make sense. So when someone is hiring a multi-7-figure, 8-figure earner, business coach, you're paying for that person's experience, their results, their wisdom. So there's going to be a price tag to that.
And I think just to put it into people's perspectives, I hired a graphic designer and I rave about her all the time because I just love her. She took my business from a 0 to a 10.
Yeah.
And I have learned so much from her. And in terms of, like, for an investment, she was expensive. And I always tell her, you know, you got to stop saying that you're expensive. I said, you are an investment and you're worth every penny. Mm-hmm. Because I said, it's going to outweigh the long-term effects of this.
Other thing is I know for myself and most other coaches, like, you can come and learn from me for $100. There's high quality content and trainings that are at every price point. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you don't have to have like crazy amount of money to start off. Like, you can get high quality trainings from myself or any other coaches for a very easy price point.
Now, how do you separate yourself from other coaches in the industry? Because like I was saying, Steph, like there are so many others. And what do you think sets yourself apart and you are this unicorn aside from other social media coaches?
I mean, it's so crazy because I don't really look at what other people do. Like, I'm so, like, here. I'm just so here. And I think, like, maybe that's what sets me apart is because I'm not, like, worried about what other people are doing and trying to do something better or as good as. I'm just so focused. And I think that I'm just me, and I think people resonate with just who I am. And I do talk a lot about work ethic. I talk a lot about really relatable stuff, and I think people are attracted to that. But I don't think about how do I be someone who stands out. I'm honestly just doing my own thing.
Good for you. Now, speaking of buying, let's talk money, Steph.
Oh, no.
You have a no-negative money mindset approach, and you talk openly about celebrating your achievements, hitting mega milestones, and you have shared that you have made $12.5 million since 2018. That is something to really worth celebrating. I would. If I made that money, damn right I'd be celebrating. But no one ever thinks that in their wildest dreams that they would become a millionaire by the time that they're in their 30s. I'm sure you never did either.
No.
And you not only celebrate these milestones in the most bougie way, but you openly talk about money and put the numbers out there. So why do you encourage your followers and clients to normalize wealth by sharing their successes on social media and celebrating?
I think the biggest thing for me is we have been conditioned to think, like, don't talk about money, right? Or don't talk about how much money you make. Like, if that means something bad, or like all you care about is money or whatever. And I think that we have been conditioned to think that money is bad. And so when I started my entrepreneurial journey, I had to look at money in a different way. I'm sure you get it too. Like, you're like, oh my God, now I have to invest this much and this is how much I'm making. Like, you have to look at money in a different way than you ever have before. So through my experience doing that, I realized that I had a negative money mindset conditioned from my family, conditioned from mm-hmm. how everyone else is conditioned. So I did work on myself to actually understand that all these stories that we have been told around money are just stories and they're not true. So I healed my relationship with money, where now I can feel very confident and open talking about wealth and money and celebrations, where it doesn't feel like, oh, I'm being wrong, or people are going to think certain things, and they will, but that's their projection based off of their conditioning. So my desire to show women this is to not only celebrate what you've created, but doing that genuinely means that you're healing your relationship with money. Like, that's what I actually want. Like, mm-hmm. the reason that someone might have a milestone but feel scared to share it publicly is because all the stories they carry around money, which is not true. So if someone can work through that, it's not just working through money. That's working through how you feel about yourself. So if someone can do that and then openly talk about money, like, that's a win beyond just sharing your celebration.
Now, Steph, when I look at you sharing openly about all your successes, I don't see any hating comments. I don't see any negative comments. I see women celebrating you. Mm-hmm. I see congratulations, and I see you reciprocating it right back.
Yeah.
Celebrating your clients and their wins. But there are haters out there, mm-hmm. and there are people who don't believe it. Mm-hmm. So what do you say to that?
Honestly, sometimes I don't say anything. Like, I don't get a lot of hate. But if I see someone, like, saying something rude or not believing it, I really just don't respond to hate. Like, I focus on what is true and what is positive. There have been times where I have responded and I've literally shown the proof of, like, tax papers, and people still do not believe you. So I realize that if people don't want to believe you, like, they're not gonna get their mind changed. So I really just focus on positivity, what is the truth, and what feels good for me. Like, I'm not trying to convince people. So I know that the truth always wins. So I just stay here, blinders on.
Haters gonna hate, and you know what? Just stay in your own lane, yeah. Do what you do. Because at the end of the day, like, you know what? Who are you to prove that to anybody?
Yeah.
So, Steph, many people are curious and puzzled and even jealous about how you have built your brand. And if you can reach this high level of success by becoming a multimillionaire social media guru in this caliber, why aren't the rest of us doing it?
I don't know. No. Well, I mean, sometimes to people it looks flashy and easy online, but you have to be someone who is batshit dedicated behind the scenes. You know, it's so possible because of the means of social media today. It's so possible because of the coaching industry, but you have to put in a lot of work. You have to navigate a lot of ups and downs. Like, this has been the hardest thing that I've ever done in my entire life. So it's not easy because of the mindset stuff. It's not easy because of the ups and downs that happen. And that's why I think most people face challenges and then they don't keep going. So I think that there's that. And because of that, I think that you have to naturally love being an entrepreneur. So there's something that I talk about a lot is, like, people think, oh, this looks easy and flashy and I'm going to feel good when I achieve that, but they don't actually love the process. You have to love the process. I love the process. Like, I love building, I love creating, and I love the ups and downs, but some people just aren't cut out for that, and there's nothing wrong with it, but you just might not reach that level of success.
I love that answer. Yeah. I love that answer, especially about being an entrepreneur too, being like, you know what, then you try doing it.
Yeah.
See what it's like.
Yeah.
And then take a walk in my shoes and see and come back at me.
I say to anyone who complains about results or, like, the process, I'm like, then why are you choosing to be an entrepreneur? You've chosen mm-hmm. to do this. Like, you literally are saying, I'm going to work hard on building something. So don't complain when it's not working yet.
Well, that's why people say, like, you know, I said goodbye to a 9-to-5.
Yeah.
To, like, actually, like, work, like, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Like,
you're a crazy person.
Yeah. But I mean, until, like, you actually walk the walk
and you get it,
then you can talk the talk.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I want to shift gears and talk about your openness, Steph, and your vulnerability with your followers about your mental health, because this has been something that you've always been open and transparent about from the get-go with your struggle with anxiety. Mm-hmm. I respect that. I always love women that, you know, are open about anything that they're going on in their lives. So why has it been always important for you to always share aspects of your journey, including the hard times?
I just feel like, one, it's natural for me. Like, I started my social media just documenting my own fitness journey, right? So it was always felt natural to just share the journey and the ups and downs. And I want people to have a real view of not just me, but, like, a view of success, right? So anytime I share anything, I want people to see the celebrations, but also the struggles. And I just feel like it makes it more relatable and therefore more achievable. And so I know, like, through the fitness days and through, like, anxiety and me sharing all these things, like, I really, at the end of the day, care about my own happiness and my own mental health, and I care about other people's happiness and mental health. And I feel like sometimes people get blindsided by, like, success only, but behind the scenes they're struggling. And I feel like if I share my struggles, it maybe makes people feel like, okay, if I'm struggling, that's okay, I can still be successful.
Well, people finally know that they're not alone, and that,
yeah.
I mean, because social media is just, it's such a mask for what's really going on behind the scenes. Like, not everybody is happy. Not everyone's having good days. Like, you and I were talking off the pod earlier, you know, about even how much work it takes to create reels and, mm-hmm. and how, you know, we're thinking, like, oh, I got to get ready and stuff. And then you put on this facade and you're like, hey, everybody, like, I'm in a great mood and I'm and this and that. And I actually, like, I'll never forget, like, when I, because I do my weekly guest announcements on Fridays, and I had just delivered our son, and I was like putting out my next podcast episode out, and I put on my face, and I was like all happy and stuff, and my graphic designer, who I cannot say enough great things about it, she was like, she just messaged me and was just like, hey, how are you doing? And I was like, oh, I'm doing really good. Like, I'm doing really great. I'm settling into my role as like a mom of like two now, and like I've been bouncing back, and I'm navigating everything. She goes, well, how? And I don't even know how it came about, but she was like, how are you and your husband navigating it? And I started bawling, Steph, because I'm like, how did you know? Like, we had a really bad day today, yeah. And I put on this facade that either she saw through it, or she just had like that instinct or something. And I was just so grateful that she had reached out and said like, but how are you guys doing? Because guess what? That day, my sister and her husband had come over and with their kids, and we had been fighting. And I was like, how are we going to navigate this? Our daughter is like hitting her child. Like, it just was so bad. And I thought like, this is real.
Yeah.
This is real life.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's just, it's so nice when people are open and talking about this, regardless of what it is. And I've always really respected you that you've said like, this is what a good day looks like, and this is what a bad day mm-hmm. looks like, and I don't always have great days.
Yeah, anytime I share something like that, I get responses of like, thank you so much, because mm-hmm. I had the worst day and I felt guilty about having the worst day. Like, that's like, I want people to not feel shame.
Yeah.
I want people to be like, it's okay to have the worst day ever and you're still good over here, you know?
Yeah.
What I mean, it's easy to feel like you judge yourself, and I think if we just stop judging ourselves, then we're good to go.
So, Steph, how have you embraced who you are and live your life unapologetically?
It's a big question. What's so interesting is I feel like most of my life growing up as a kid, teenager, in university, like, I was so unhappy and not confident, right? The opposite of what I am today. And I feel like most of my life living, feeling like I'm in a box. Once I started to just let myself be me, I was like, this feels so good. This feels like freedom. So the confidence I have today and the drive that I have to always connect back to my heart and what is true for me is because I spent most of my years thinking that that wasn't good enough, right? And so you just, one day it happened for me, I'm like, I can't live like this anymore, and I just freed myself, and here I am.
All right, Steph, well, this has been enlightening, to say in the least. This has been so fun, and we're going to continue the fun.
Yeah.
And we're going to move into my rapid 10.
Okay.
All right. Steph, why do you charge in USD if you are in Canada?
Because I'm an international business.
Plain and simple. There you go.
Bring it on.
Steph, what is Voxer?
These are the best questions. Voxer is just like a group messaging app.
Okay. I've always been so curious about Voxer. What was your first thought when you noticed your Instagram account had been shut down?
Fuck.
How did you come across your coach, Melanie Ann Lair?
I'm friends with someone on Facebook, and they had shared her, and I clicked on one video, and after a couple of minutes of a live stream, I messaged her and hired her.
And I've heard that several women in the Ottawa Valley have hired her as their coach now, too.
Yeah.
You recently posted 7 reasons why your monthly income isn't generating more revenue. What's one reason that pertains to anyone?
Your content sucks.
We should stop looking at women thinking, wow, she's so lucky, and start thinking, what?
She worked hard.
Damn right. Who are the faces behind Team XO?
Jake, Brittany, and Andy. The best people ever. Jake's right there.
Who is another local boss babe that inspires you, Steph, that you think everyone should know about?
So I have 2, Callie, who is part of this, and Emma from Picket Fence. And I want to share why, because years ago, before this was even a thing, they have been so supportive of just like sponsoring things, or you know what I mean? Like, it mm-hmm. just, every time that I would go in there or ask for something, like, can I do a giveaway for like this little thing? Like, it felt so small. They have always just been like having open arms and supportive, and it means the world to me.
I totally get that.
Yeah.
I feel that reciprocation as well with everybody that has supported me. And it's funny because everyone that has supported me in my business have all been women. And I mm-hmm. always think, you know what? You keep that
Something
in your back
about
pocket.
That. Yeah.
Yeah. You keep that in your back pocket and be like, you know what? You support me and I will always support you, no matter what you do in life.
Yeah. Those relationships are so important.
For sure. Steph, thank you so much for being a part of the podcast.
Thank you so much. This was so fun.
This was so fun. Cheers to you and all the success. And let's celebrate your 12.5 million. Woo!